Welcome to the Cyber Intelligence Briefing, the podcast from SRM, bringing you cybersecurity news and insights straight from our experts. My name is Stephen Ross. I'll be your host for this episode, which is all about cybersecurity talent and skills, which, if you've read the news, are reportedly both in short supply. I'm delighted to be joined by two SRM colleagues based here in the U.S. to discuss these issues. Firstly, welcome Paul Caron, head of cyber in the Americas.
Hey, Stephen. Delighted to be here. Thank you.
And also with me is Rhiannon Dixon, a manager at SRM.
Thank you, Steve. I'm happy to be here.
So we've got a couple areas to get into today. Specifically, we'll be starting with cyber talent and cyber skills. Let's kick it off with talent. Paul, at your level, what do you see as the issue here? What are some of the challenges when it comes to cyber talent?
So, Stephen, that's a great question. You know, when we look at the talent shortage in the market today, I think it comes down to a couple of key factors. Number one, there's still a little bit of ambiguity when, you know, those that don't or aren't very close to the music within cyber hear about those vacancies, those job openings. It feels very daunting. And unless you come from a very technical background, you might not understand that the cybersecurity profession is very, very far reaching and wide. So there's software skill areas, there's more technical skill areas. There's areas where, you know, a lot of, as we've seen here within our team, team members find their niche, if you will, but it wasn't until really scratching deeper at the surface. So I think that it all boils down to a broader education campaign on what the profession entails, how many different facets of that profession there are, and how to really get into them. I see another issue that we're seeing is that there's a, you know, of course, as I referred to on other discussions, there's a little bit of a gatekeeping or, you know, badge protection mentality around breaking into the field. So sometimes we see that there's junior level positions out there posted on, you know, your favorite social media sites or job boards, and they want an entry level position with, you know, at least 2 to 3 years working experience within cyber. And it's, you know, as we hear many times as we're in conferences, it's a little bit contradictory. So I think as, you know, cyber leaders in the field, we need to be more open to identifying, you know, talent that's going to be woven into the culture of the organization, but ultimately culture of carriers, and that you want to make that investment into to train, develop, and mentor that skill.
Okay, great. Thanks, Paul. So it sounds like what we're experiencing is a bit of a spiral of rising demand for cyber talent, which kind of feeds into competition for overall talent, and then that pushes up costs to employers. Paul, before we go over to Rhiannon, can you touch a little bit on how those criteria are affecting SRM's growth? How is this impacting SRM in general?
So, I mean, ultimately, you know, we're very fortunate in the light that we've made active investments by developing the SRM Academy, in which we have taken non-traditional hires and really upskilled them through a series of business unit level round robins across digital forensics and incident response to advisory services to other parts of business to really help foster that journey from point A to point B to really take best-in-class talent that has the tenacity and desire to learn cybersecurity skills and make them successful in our, you know, various parts of our global business. Conversely, you know, to your point about the spiraling rise of demand and the competition of talent, you know, at the end of the day, we all, you know, harp our horns on how many vacancies there are currently, but you know, when you look around the landscape, there are not a lot of organizations that are making that active investment end over end. So you start seeing the same faces kind of playing centrifuge, you know, organization to organization. And all that does is it keeps one, you know, resource going round and round versus amplifying that talent pool. So inherently, you know, market demands and conditions for that go up. The cybersecurity professionals in the field, you know, are working hard. So sometimes there's, you know, a value proposition there for chasing the best opportunity at the best time for the best resource. And it gets pretty complicated out there.
Great. Yeah, that's valuable input, Paul. We appreciate that. I want to shift here for a second and bring in Rhiannon Dixon, who's maybe experiencing the talent at her level a little bit more. But before we get into the talent shortage, Rhiannon, can you tell us a little bit about what's attractive to you about a career in cybersecurity? What's drawn you specifically to this industry, to this field?
Absolutely, Steve. So the short answer is everything. Everything about a career in cybersecurity is attractive. And yes, if you are listening to this and not already working in a career in cybersecurity, please reach out to us, consider it. We need you. But the longer answer is that cybersecurity is really the closest I could get to working in science fiction. And what I mean by that is, Paul was mentioning earlier that the cybersecurity field is really broad and there are a lot of different ways to specialize. But one thing that I do see in all of the best cybersecurity professionals is they're all really living in the future all the time, whether they're anticipating the moves of threat actors, predicting the user needs that will spark the next IT revolution, forecasting business disruptors and geopolitical events. The one thing they all have in common is they are planning out how to secure and prepare for the future. Now, the amazing benefits, the travel, the support for ongoing learning and development, all of those things are great perks too. But it's definitely the aspect that really drew me to cybersecurity is the time travel and the feeling of getting to just live in the future and be on the cusp of what's next.
Awesome. Very cool. We're glad you're at SRM. That's a unique perspective that Rhiannon has on that. Paul, kind of building off of where Rhiannon's talked about, as far as the industry being great to work in, what do you see as a key blocker preventing folks from taking that step into cyber and helping close the gap?
So, you know, a lot of universities are doing, and also non-traditional, you know, education routes are doing a really great job at trying to really highlight what the art of the possible is within the industry. But I still feel that, you know, across, you know, some of the other, you know, more prominent degrees out there or career paths, this still needs more awareness. You know, I mean, when you think about cybersecurity, not long ago, it was, you know, maybe, you know, boringly labeled information assurance, or then it kind of jumped to information security with, you know, some different pockets there. And then, of course, then it went to cybersecurity. And now, even in other areas, you know, such as the government, they're expanding into, you know, central commands within cybersecurity. So yeah, now you have cyber command. So it's growing very prolifically on multiple different fronts. But I still think that when you walk up to someone and, you know, that's not in the industry and you say, hey, what does cybersecurity, what does it mean to you? They might think of it as a really abstract concept and something that, you know, is hyper-specialized. Only a couple of people in the world can do it and it doesn't seem tangible. So I think that the awareness and making it front and center for accessibility, you know, specifically for those, you know, populations that might be in more rural areas or might be underserved or might just have never heard of cybersecurity until maybe a career fair. Just getting more accessibility out there for them is really a big thing.
Great. Yeah, that's a really solid point. Accessibility to the field is definitely a big hurdle. Paul, at SRM, we've highlighted diversity efforts in our hiring. Do you want to touch on that at all and how that can be used as a bridge of the gap from a cyber skills and talent perspective?
Certainly. You know, I think one of the things that really calls out to my passion is, you know, and resonates with my own personal story is, you know, taking a bet on non-traditional hires, right? Once upon a time after my career in the military, as you recall, Steve, you know, there was a big veterans initiative to hire those in the cyber across multiple professional services firms. And, you know, unfortunately, someone saw in me and others that we could be, you know, a good person to learn those skills, you know, kind of bridging that gap. We've done that really well here. You know, as I mentioned, the SRM Academy has done, I think, an exceptional way to really bring in best-in-class talent from not only other areas of our business, such as corporate intelligence and strategic intelligence and other areas of, you know, support that we offer for our clients, but ultimately just from really bright and ambitious college graduates that want to get into cyber, but of course, you know, as I mentioned, just might not have had the right, you know, either avenue or accessibility or broader view that they knew of someone that was in cyber. So we've done a really great job of sifting through that talent to really identify those that want to get into it. And then we help, you know, open up the aperture to enable their success.
Yeah, well said. Non-traditional hires, kind of doubling down into that diversity is definitely a focus area we've taken. And I agree with you. I think it has shown benefits. Okay, so let's start talking a little bit more about the actual cyber skills here. So In our annual Cybersecurity Insights report, we learned that over a third of senior IT leaders and C-suite professionals, roughly 35%, highlight a lack of cyber skills and expertise as a key challenge facing their business when it comes to cybersecurity defense and incident management. So 35% of these senior leaders saying there's a lack of skills generally in the market. Paul, what's going on here? Is this the same question? Does this boil down to cyber talent, or you think there's something larger at play here?
So, you know, when I read that, it resonated, right? You know, many times I'll be out at a lunch or other professional networking event, and, you know, I'm having the same conversations with CIOs and CISOs and, you know, those that have the function and responsibility to really oversee cybersecurity. And especially when we think about incident response and cyber defense as a whole, it's such an interesting part of the ecosystem of talent that, you know, it's basically, as Rhiannon said, you know, you have to be really, really strong in the bleeding edge of technology and understanding the adversary, right? We think about, you know, on our team, the responders that we have and digital forensics experts that we have that are just all stars. They're very, they don't approach the same problem set the same way. And they're very, very much of the mindset of, you know, I'll call it asymmetrical thinking, meaning that they're problem solvers, right? They're thinking about things in 4D, right? They're thinking about things in the light of the threat actor or the bad guy and what they could do or had done to propagate that attack. So sometimes, you know, the best cybersecurity professionals in one, you know, specific facet of the business might not be best suited for that defense and incident management role. You know, we joke around many times that being an incident response is much akin to being a firefighter, right? You might have lulls in a day, but then when the fire goes off and the alarms are on, you know, you're jumping in the truck and you're going to the next emergency. It's a different mindset, it's a different way of life and pace of play altogether. So with that, sometimes you do see talent that gets, you know, pushed into specific functional areas within an organization at the enterprise level, and they're just not as successful because, again, it doesn't resonate with their personality and their way of tackling things.
Yeah, well said. Well said. Okay, so let's turn to Rhiannon here. Rhiannon, you work with organizations of all types to improve their cybersecurity maturity. What are some of the key things from your perspective that will help businesses in the short term to close those skills gaps within their existing teams?
Absolutely, Steve. So I have three main ideas here. So the first is to encourage participation in the broader security community. So going back to what Paul was noting earlier, organizations that partner with and already have employees who are active members from groups like Women in Cybersecurity, Blacks in Cybersecurity, Women Who Code, the list goes on. Those organizations have access to an amazing pipeline of professionals. If and when they choose to expand their cybersecurity team, already having those connections is a huge first step. Second thing that I would note is to reward a culture of coaching. All of the turning points in my personal cyber career that have been the most pivotal and informative for me have come from mentors who are really going above and beyond to teach me. They were investing their time and energy, and I've seen organizations where leadership really notices and cultivates that behavior, and those organizations are generally a lot more mature and more secure than those that don't. Then thirdly, I would recommend training all users in security foundations. Having a skilled cyber workforce is important, but the organization with the largest cybersecurity department still won't necessarily be the most secure organization because IT and cyber, they're still only a fraction of the overall organizational headcount. There's a lot to be said for providing a strong foundation of cybersecurity awareness and education to all members of the business. Organizations are only as secure as their weakest link, and by investing in recurring, real-time, ideally gamified security training for all members of the organization, that not only improves security at an operational level, it also really reduces the workload for the security team, which helps the security team in terms of closing that skills gap in the short term.
Wow, I love that. Great answer. So to recap for the audience there, the three key pieces to help teams close that cyber skills gap were number one, encouraging participation in some of those alternative talent pipelines, the earlier the better, so those that talent can be onboarded in a meaningful way. But number two, rewarding coaching, as you mentioned, Rhiannon, and number three was training all users in the security foundations. I love that you touched on that an organization is only as secure as its weakest link. We find ourselves saying that to clients quite frequently. So love that you brought that up. Well, this brings our overall discussion around cyber talent and skills to an end, but Paul, Rhiannon, and myself, and indeed the rest of the global SRM cyber team are here to talk to you further about specific cyber challenges your organization may face. Stick around for our next episode where we'll be talking a little bit more about nation state threat actors and where we see the trend in the industry going. Thanks, everyone.